Good morning, everyone. Hope you're well. I've been looking forward to today for some time now. First of all, I'd like to welcome back to our family of press, family, Gary Carter. Gary, I'm glad to see you here, mate. And I'm glad to see you looking so much better than you've been and improving all the time.
Oh, thank you.
And I'm looking forward to doing battles with you in due course. But for now, we'll come back.
Cheers, thank you.
The last time I saw you, I think it was in the tribunal back in Manchester, and I did say to you, we're going to sign Daniel Vido and Justin Carney, and you argued with me. And I said to you, you are entitled to your opinion, but in my opinion, your opinion is wrong. So welcome back, and I'm looking forward to doing battles with you.
Cheers, thank you.
Following that tribunal I was referring to, the RFL initiated an investigation into the affairs of our club, and soon afterwards they've issued some charges, and in their findings of that investigation, I need to make this absolutely clear, that they found the club have not breached any salary cap regulations in 2016, so we were clear there. The same applied to 2015. However, they charged us for on six things. One, can you read that? Yeah? That we breached the 2014 salary cap. And just to protect the privacy of players or clubs, etc., I'm not going to mention any names or clubs. I'm just going to refer to them as A, B, C, D, and F. So, the second charge against the club was involving player A to do with a car given to him. Player B, side payment. Four, player C, rent. Five, player D, rent payment. When I say rent, rent that we have made on behalf of the player that we haven't declared in the salary cap. And six, player E, to do with leadership training and payment that has been made to that particular player. And it's the tribunal that involved, that I was referring to earlier with Gary, that involved the player E. A hearing took place on the 25th of April at the RFL that took 3 hours to consider all the cases there, where this particular case took almost 2 days in an employment tribunal. So for all the cases there to be discussed, you know, to consider the outcome and to come up to a conclusion, it only took 3 hours. The club was found not guilty here, the car. No evidence whatsoever was presented to the tribunal as in regarding player B, so that was dismissed. They claimed that we should have declared a rent payment of £7,500 as in regarding to player C. We should have declared a rent of £10,800 to there. And according to the statement of the player, a total of £32,200, I think, the exact figure, regarding player E. Now, if you add the three sums involved here, then the exact amount, was £51,200. And this is the figure I'm gonna come back to in a minute. Before I do that, player E is to do with, and I, you know, for this, because it's subject to an appeal, I don't really want to go in details. But I'd like to ask my colleagues at the RFL, guys, you knew about this in October 2014. Why didn't you take action then? And maybe Mark Green is right in wanting to know why didn't they take action there. And this very file that the RFL produced, there's evidence there, there's written evidence to indicate that the RFL had known about this back in October 2014. And I know they did, because I discussed it with them as well. Also, player C, which I believe it's total administrative mistake but on our part, which was corrected, was it in March 2015, whatever. It's to do with a rent that we were paying on behalf of a player that we did not declare in the salary cap. But that's totally a mistake. But again, the RFL knew about this. And knew about it more than a year ago. Why didn't they do something then? Why wait until basically the end of last year to start an investigation? They didn't need to start an investigation. The information is there in black and white. But nevertheless, that's a decision being reached that they found us guilty with payments of £51,200. That, they claim.
One quick question. I just can't work out those figures because it might be my maths mile, but I get back to £50,500.
Maybe.
£32,900, like you said originally.
No, the exact figure, £10,800 and £32,200. So that's £32,200. That's £10,800 and that's £7,500.
That's £50,500, not £51,200. There's just a £700 discrepancy there, that's all.
Well, I'll check my exact figures, but listen, it's neither here nor there, but it's an amount of around the 51,000. Then, all of a sudden, I get a letter, and claims were made in the tribunal that says Salford have exceeded their total aggregate liability of 1.919200 for a period of 109 days. That means we are over the cap by 94,200. 94,200. Trying to think. You run a live salary cap. You monitor that salary cap. You don't allow anybody to go over that salary cap. And even if Salford, on every single day of that salary cap, were spending the total amount, i.e. the 1.825, surely the maximum that we could have breached is by 51,000. This is a schoolboy error. There's no way on earth we could have been in breach of the cap by that amount. Now, for the benefit of those, I'll come back, I'll use this word. For the benefit of those who are not familiar, with what's meant by a life salary cap. It's almost like a bank statement, right? You start the season with whatever players you've got. You submit that to the RFL, and do we have a red marker? And let's say the salary cap is 1.825 million. Right? You go to the RFL and you say, Mr. RFL, this is the players we've got at the start of the season. We'd like to ignore those payments, the side payments for now, right? Because obviously we didn't declare them at the time. And they'll take the figure of us, and through the season, you move players out and you move them in, like every other club. And the salary cap officer will make sure no club exceeds that amount. And in actual fact, and I've got our salary cap position here, and before the meeting, I had shared the information I've got here with one of you guys, Ian, right? And even if you to add that amount of money to our log, or the amount of money we were spending, the amount of money we were spending ranged from 1.75, and sometimes it's 1.622. We only breached the cap of this 1.825 on the 9th of July until the 17th of July, 2014. So during this period, we go above this red line by something like 50K. Right? So their claims of 109 days is absolutely ridiculous. And they could, and I'll come back to that in a second. And for me, when I look at why they've done it, I would say they either deliberately misled the judge of the tribunal, or they were totally incompetent. So I started looking, why did we breach the cap by 50K during that season? During that time, I always knew we had enough money in the cap to spend money. To those who follow or followed our club, I take you back to May of 2014, in which we had a player called Jake Bolani. Do you remember him? And he used to be our fullback. And in May 2014, we've also signed, yeah, 2014, we signed Kevin Locke to come to us in December for the following year. But unfortunately, Jake suffered an injury on the 17th of May, long-term injury, and he was out for the season. So I went to the RFL, I said to them, Mr. RFL, we need the overseas spot for Jake, and we need to free room in the cap. Can you please deregister Jake in order to bring Kevin from Australia? And the answer was yes. And we brought Kevin back. We brought Kevin into the club in July. Now, you would have thought a sensible governing body would have deregistered Jake, then registered Kevin. They've done it the other way around. So on the 9th of July, they've registered Kevin, and only deregistered Jade on the 17th of July, which resulted in the club going over the cap for that week. If they want to dispute the facts, then we only went over the cap by that amount for that length of time, and during which time we only played one game, and that is the game we played against Hull FC, I think. Right, there's a reason why I said the 9th of July here. Because for you, some of you, I would like you to look at the date in which Kevin Locke made his debut for us. He played at Huddersfield on Sunday that I believe it was the 5th of July. Mr. Arafel, are you telling us that you allowed Kevin Locke to play without being registered? Your salary log is full of elementary errors, and for a governing body to be producing something like that, I would be embarrassed being part of a sport that's governed by a body, right, that produces a log like this. This log is almost like a bank statement. Just imagine if you received a bank statement and said to you, you know, you started with £100, then there's a withdrawal here of £20, and not giving you the date of the withdrawal. Or you've withdrawn £30,000, but we will confirm the date. This is what the log says here to me. There's a number of entries here without dates. There's a number of entries here that says to confirm. Guys, this is in 2014. Are you not capable of monitoring a cap, the salary cap? The salary cap is at the heart of the competition. There's players here who are on our cap that were on loan. But nevertheless, if we to accept they've made mistakes and this is what we've got, then this is my argument of why we went over the cap for that time. So really, this is a technical breach, and we haven't breached the cap whatsoever. Their figures of 94,200, where it's 51,200, it's, you know, they should be embarrassed. And to claim it was for 109 days, it's embarrassing. I am aware that mistakes weren't just made with my club, monitor the salary cap. There was another club that they went over the cap by about, not about, but the exact amount of £158,060 during 2014. And we can't, don't even start speculating about the club. Right, this is a live salary cap. And if a club goes over the cap, good luck to them. The people who were responsible for monitoring the cap are at fault. And on the 8th of December, a meeting took place in Media City for a coffee, and they turned around and said to this club, no action will be taken against you. Guys, you could understand why I'm so frustrated. A, it starts here, deliberate misleading of the court by false claims. Looking at our life salary cap, we haven't breached. And still dishing out a 6-point penalty. Despite the fact those facts were in their possession almost 2 years ago, and to bring it and charge us now when we're just getting our house in order is disgusting, to say the least. So where do we go from here? We went to appeal, and last week we had asked RFL whether they would consider listening to the appeal or referring the appeal to an independent body that they themselves recognize, which is the Sports Resolution. It's totally independent of Salford, totally independent of the RFL. And for a week, we haven't heard from them. But when I spoke to my lawyer this morning, he says to me, we just heard from them, and they're saying, referring the appeal to the Sports Resolution is under the discretion of the RFL. And they will only make that decision once they had seen the grounds of the appeal. Actual fact, there's so many grounds in which we could appeal. And I really wanted to know where is the appeal going to take place before we decide. And I just don't know why the RFL needs to see our grounds of appeal in order to make their decision. If nobody has anything to hide, let's take the case to an independent appeal. Somewhere independent, away from Red Hall, and it could only be fair to, it's fair to everybody there. So in conclusion, before I move into other stuff, I would like to know, or I would like the RFL to come out and give an answer to everybody. Why they waited for so long from October 2014 and July 2015, when they had the evidence. Why did they wait for so long to come out and charge the club? Are there other situations, are they doing the same with other people, and they're only gonna charge clubs if it becomes public? They had no more evidence now than they did have then. Second point I'd like to know is they need to explain why they have given the hearing wrong figures, i.e. the discrepancy between these two laws. And they need to explain their failure in monitoring a salary cap. I spoke yesterday about my fear for the future of rugby league. And I'm aware, and everybody here is aware, of the next Aussie TV deal. And I'm thinking the sport is facing a lot of challenges. And if we're not careful, not only will we become a feeder competition to the NRL, but could threaten the status of the sport, i.e. maybe become a semi-professional sport rather than what it is now. And do I look at the people who are leading us, the likes of Nigel Wood or Ralph Rimmer and Karen Morehouse, and I look at what's going on here and there, and the lack of commercial, their income that they're generating. Do I think they are capable of taking us to the next level or facing the challenges we're facing? I don't think so. Unfortunately, my good friend Nigel, instead of standing up to these challenges, goes out and brings in a team from, a second team from France, and a second team from Canada. I'll come back to those two teams. I don't know what's the logic behind it, right? I mean, is he trying to create two more Catalans in the competition, which I presume the ultimate aim? Why would the Canadian be wanting to invest so much money if their ultimate aim is not to be in Super League? But let's look at Catalan, right? They are, unless we fund them, if we play Wakefield, for example, my club will bear the travel expenses to go there. If Wakefield come to play us, they pay their own travel expenses. When we go to play Catalan, we have to fund a substantial amount of money for travel. If Catalan comes to play us, we also have to fund their travel expenses. Their participation in the sport, apart from the amount of money they take in central funding, is costing each club around £100,000. I am all for growing the sport. Not in this country, but in other countries, including in France. But I know 10 years ago, the French said their aim is to have 75% of their players playing for France, qualified to play for France. That's on record. I look at the team that we played recently. 11 of them do not qualify to play for France. That's about 70, in actual fact, it's almost 75% of the players don't qualify to play for France. So we failed there. We failed to grow the sport. But then when I look at the players closely, I notice there are at least 9 overseas players. I'm not counting Jody and Richie Myler being in it, because they're English. 9 non-European players. And I'm thinking, hang on a minute, every team is allowed only 7. How come Catalan is getting 9? You know, rugby league is a small village. For us owners, we get offered players that end up going to somewhere else. Every agent will shop a player around. And after our game, when I looked at their starting 13, and I put the value down to what I think they're worth. The starting 13 almost more than 1.825. So, I mean, what have we achieved in investing so much money in France? We've integrated the game. We contribute to their local economy. I think our fans and players, when they go over there throughout the course of the year, they must contribute at least £10 million to the local economy. When they come here, other than funding their travel expenses, they don't bring any fans at all. The number of French players playing in the team is not the 75% we told they were going to be. The government or the RFL, I think it's their baby. Catalan is their baby. And when we look at the discipline, for example, we look at what Dave Taylor has done to a couple of our players, and they just said, no, he's okay. We've queried. If that had happened, if one of our players done it to theirs, would have been a lot more severe. And I'm saying these things, I have a lot of respect for people in Catalan, their players, a lot of them, people I socialize with and I know. It's not against them, it's against the governing body. that allows them to get away with things like that. Then all of a sudden we hear from our good friend Nigel that Toulouse are here and they are in Championship One. Not against that. As long as it doesn't end up another Catalan, i.e. we fund them and they're costing their sport money. Straight away I'm told that actually Toulouse are getting some favors already. And I ask what it is. He says, this person I was talking to says, every championship club gets about £75,000. Toulouse get an excess of £200,000. Wow. Where's the money coming from? About it's coming from Super League. We break competitions, you know, whether it's Super League, Championship, or Championship One, where it's level playing field. So I'd like to ask the RFL question, how come you're giving Toulouse more money than any other Championship One? Finally, come back to Toronto. And sometimes I really don't know whether to laugh or cry at some of the ideas my good friend Nigel come up with. But it's assumed it's viable. And he says they will fund everything. And Toronto, and good luck to them, and I hope it does work. Because I'm all out, I'm all for growth, but we need to do things and we need to be careful. We need to consider, for example, with the French, you know, what are the benefits and what is the cost? They're talking about TV money. Is it going to be similar to the TV money that we are getting out from the French? Does anybody know what the value here? No? €50,000 a year. That's the value of the TV, French TV money. I hope it's not going to be just 50,000 Canadian dollars with the Canadians. But we are allowing here a group of people to go out and sign players. And they already started signing players and coaches, etc. And it is a risky venture. One question I would like to ask RFL. This club you're given a license to operate in Championship One, have they provided you with a proof of funding? And if the answer is yes, then my second question, have you got bank guarantees to secure the future of the players that they're signing? And the viability of the club for the 3 years. I'm going to stop here and I'm going to take any questions you have.
Talk about the registration of players. So you played Kevin Locke when it wasn't actually registered.
Angela, I don't really know, but according to the log, salary cap log here, now we would have been given the clearance, because what you do is you send your player, you know, you're 19, and if there's any problems, they come to you. But according, and do you want to come over, I'll show you this.
Yeah.
It says 9th of July. Lock into FTS, which is the first team squad.
Yeah.
I don't understand this. And that's his value. So on the 9th of July, that's when he was registered in our camp. Can anybody before this year find out when did Kevin Lock play for us against Huddersfield? I think you'll find out it's on the 5th of July. And for me, this is, you know, when I say the RFL are not fit for purpose, You know, you look at the purpose of the RFL. At the heart of that is the monitoring of the salary cap. If they're not able to monitor that and administer it properly, then they are not fit for purpose.
I just wanted to get clear, though, that if he wasn't registered by them until the 9th of July and he was played on the 5th of July, then you played a player that hadn't been registered.
We have played a player that's given to us the clearance to play.
Yeah,
but not on the salary cap. They have not. I'm talking about clearances here or different clearances. And we would have not come out and all of a sudden put Kevin Locke there. The way it works, you submit your 19 to the RFL, and the RFL would then, you know, would give you the clearance. But the player was not on our